Throughout our lives, our families can be our biggest sources of happiness or unhappiness. In a moment, we're going to introduce you to our new series called Love at Home, where we're going to share ideas of how to build a strong Christian family. You won't want to miss this episode of Better Life Today. Hello, I'm Doug Garcia, and welcome to this episode of Better Life Today. Sayidi Rodriguez is with me. Sayidi, welcome.
Thank you.
This is our number one of a series we plan to do called Love at Home.
Yes.
And we're going to explain what this means to the audience in just a moment. But Sayidi, if somebody wants to find an example of a good Christian family, where would they look? Would they look on television?
I don't think so.
No, that's not. You look on TV nowadays, and you know what you see is a lot of dysfunctional families. Mm-hmm. And it seems like the more bizarre and the more weird the family is, the more likely it's to be on a television show.
Right. And I think about that Bible verse that says, by beholding you become changed. Obviously, the Bible verse is talking of Jesus. By looking to Jesus, we become more like him. But if you're thinking about television, what we are watching, then that starts happening at home.
That's right. That's where you get your example of what a father is, what a mother is, and how the kids are supposed to behave. You watch TV, and that is your example. You raise your kids up, that's their example.
You know that I remember babysitting a little boy, and as he was watching the television, I remember thinking, what? Because on this particular show, they were showing a family where the kids were basically the ones that were ruling the house, making the rules and just making the parents look so bad.
Yeah, it seems very typical to have the father as being portrayed as very dumb or stupid, and the kids run the home and they're smart alecks and they get away with everything. Yeah. That seems to be the model, and that's what's being presented to people day after day after day. And besides television, though, you can even walk down the street sometimes and you hear people in their house yelling and screaming at each other within their families.
Right.
So the question once again is, where do you find examples or ideas for a good Christian family? Mm-hmm. And I thought, let's do a program about it. Let's look around and find some ideas and get some solutions that we can present to the Better Life audience about what would a good Christian home look like.
Right.
So we've gotten together, and I've got some ideas for future programs.
Okay.
You want to hear some of those ideas?
Please.
Okay, this is the introductory program. But in the future, what I'd like to do is a program about what does a good Christian dad look like? Wouldn't it be nice to know?
I think that would be such a blessing for many.
And good ideas about what a Christian dad could do?
Yes.
And we can do the same thing for mom. What does a good Christian mom look like? What about a program about how to solve problems without yelling and screaming?
Oh, that's a good one.
You know, every family has a problem. You got to solve something, or you want to do something and somebody else wants to do something else. So how can you get through all of these problems and still be loving towards each other? That would be a good program. Okay. Tips on dealing with teens.
Oh,
there is a time period in children's lives where things change dramatically for them. And a lot of times in the family, that's when things can get out of control.
Yeah.
So we should have a program just about dealing about teens, teen issues. And then what about kids and electronics? Mm-hmm. Nowadays, that's a big thing. When you and I were growing up, less of a thing. But now kids always are in their computer.
It's constantly. Yeah.
So we need to do a program about that, because parents, I don't think, know what's going on behind the scenes with those kids. I kind of keep track of it because of my job in the media to know what's going on. And I am shocked at what kids are getting involved with nowadays. And a lot of it is through their handheld devices.
That's right.
We should do a program about that. Ideas for family worship. I wonder how many families in our viewing community have worship each morning together and at night. Well, let's find some ideas about how to do that, because it's important to have that as the base of your family. You start every day with the Lord. You end every day with the Lord. And you say, our family is for the Lord.
It makes such a big difference.
Yeah. Creative ideas when you need to discipline your kids. You know, parents come in there's no instruction manual when the baby's born, is there? But you need ideas about how are you going to discipline these kids.
Yes.
Let's do a program on that too. What to do if you don't have a family. You know, God made us to be social and to have that family bonds, but there are people out there who for various reasons do not have families.
Okay.
We need to talk about that. How
like
can
it.
you maybe take on a surrogate family, something. Might be a good idea. And then maybe even a program on homeschooling. A lot of people say, I don't want to send my kids to public school because the influences there are getting worse and worse. Mm-hmm. Well, we can talk about what can you do with homeschooling.
Right. And I think something that it's important to share with our viewers is that obviously you and I, we don't have children. And at the same time, we'll share the little bit that we know and also have people helping us.
That's the good part about this program is we can go interview tons of people who have, in fact, on this show today, a little bit later, we're going to show an interview we did with somebody who has some wisdom for us.
Yes.
So we can go out there and find these ideas for our audience.
So for this program, it's not just going to be you and I talking.
That's right. We've got some people coming up in just a minute. In fact, the topic we chose for this program today, our number one program, is simply mentors.
Mm-hmm.
Mentors. And you may say, is that a family topic? Well, you're going to understand how in just a little bit.
But first,
Saidi, would you give me a definition of the word mentor?
So a mentor would be someone that is able to make the time to be able to help someone that may have less of an experience, most of the time younger than you. So you kind of go through with them through a situation or even through life, just kind of sharing the experience that you have, training, helping.
And we want to concentrate especially in this program about godly mentors.
Yes.
Because you can have a mentor who teaches you a skill, mm-hmm. like woodworking, photography, whatever. But what's really important in this day and age is to have godly mentors to help you spiritually mm-hmm. and with spiritual issues. So we want to focus on that for today.
I agree.
There are mentors for parents. A parent can have a mentor outside the home.
That's right.
So even if we're talking about families, we can talk about people from outside who have influence upon mm-hmm. the family. Because a lot of times families don't have solid mentors in the family.
Right.
The parents may not be Christian. Mm-hmm. Just a bunch mm-hmm. of different combinations there. Grandparents make wonderful mentors. If you have a godly grandparent, somebody who's patient and kind, you can have a wonderful mentor in a grandparent.
Right.
So we want to
touch
on that. Mm-hmm. But there's a Bible text for today to get us into the topic of mentors. Would you share that?
Of course. Yeah. And it's found in Proverbs 1, verse 8. And it says, my son, hear the instruction of your father, and do not forsake the law of your mother.
Some versions say the teaching of your mother.
Uh-huh.
Yeah. The same idea, though, is that the counsel in Proverbs is listen to somebody mm-hmm. of greater experience.
Yeah.
It's very, very important. Now, Saidi, did you have any mentors in your life?
Oh, yes, I did.
Tell me about it.
I had so many. And so when we were thinking about this, I thought, okay, who should I talk about? There was one person that came to my life. Obviously, my mom would be my number one mentor.
Mm-hmm.
But someone that actually came from outside and blessed the family was my boss. One of my first bosses,
yeah.
That's how you would say.
Yeah.
My mom, when she came to the United States, the kind of jobs that she was doing did not include an interview. She didn't have to do an interview. And my dad, yes, he went through many interviews, but yet, as much as I love my daddy and he's a wonderful man, there was not that, we didn't have that communication so that he can come and say, okay, when you get interviewed, this is what you do, this is what you don't do, and it's going to be like this.
Oh, okay.
So I remember one time, it was my dream job. And so the person that was going to interview me was who was going to become my boss. And he said, I'm going to meet you at the university. And from then I'm going to do the interview. So I go there with high heels and, you know, just kind of trying to look my best and very, very nervous. I get there and he's not really dressed up like I thought he was going to be. And he goes, okay, come into the car. We're going to take a little drive. And I thought, okay, this is very different, very strange. So he takes me up to next to the university where I was going to. There's this like park. Mm-hmm. Mountain kind of park, and he starts walking, and then he started telling me about the trees. I'll never forget the name of the tree, Madrone, I think it's called, mm-hmm. and he would talk about them, and I thought, this is a very strange interview, but he just wants to talk. So I was like, oh, yes, and he would test me. I didn't know he was testing me, but he would say, so the tree, what did I tell you was the name? And I was like, oh, the Madrone, and he was like, yeah. And then he would say, so tell me about your life. And it was very casual, mm-hmm. very beautiful. I just thought that I was having a conversation with someone, mm-hmm. just, you know, a friend kind of a thing. When we came back, I thought, okay, now we're going to the interview. My high heels were now all dirty, dusty. And he says, well, that was the end of the interview. And I said, what do you mean? And he said, I ask you every single question that is asked during the interview. I ask maybe in a different way. And he said, in just like a conversation, because you were so nervous, he said. He said, it's important to make sure that the person is feeling comfortable. Well, that was just the beginning. Because from then on, when I started working for him, he would make the time to explain to me things that I didn't know before, and especially things that related to working and having God in your life. He said, never forget to stay humble and on your knees. Wow. He said, it's important to be humble. It's important to seek the Lord in prayer constantly. And it just made such a big difference to be able to work for this person who for a time was my mentor and taught me so many things.
Can you imagine what influence that would have on young people if they were to have somebody who would tell them, be humble,
right?
Keep on your knees. Mm-hmm. God will guide you through your life. Well, what am I going to do with school? What major should I ask God? Let him lead you.
Yes.
And you know, I was talking to a young person the other day, and we were talking about what that person is going to do for their life. Mm-hmm. And I said things like, well, you know, you need to enjoy what you do. That's important. You need to do this. But at the very end, I said, but you know, the most important thing is you let God show you what he wants you to do. Mm-hmm. Because, you know, you look in the Bible, a lot of people didn't know what their plan for their life was going to be. Joseph would not have signed up for prison, but that was the Lord's plan.
Right.
Moses wouldn't have done certain things he did, you know, staying with the sheep, but that was God's plan.
Yeah.
So it's always important. You need a mentor to tell you, let God lead you. It may be a path you don't even imagine,
right.
But it's very important to let God mm-hmm. lead you. Wow. Well, there was, let's take a break because I want to get into some other ideas
okay.
and options. And you have a video clip that you're going to share. Mm-hmm. You went to your church members and you asked them who their mentors were.
I did. And they had really good answers.
Yeah. So we're going to show that clip next and talk more about mentors when we return right after this.
Amen.
Hello and welcome back to Better Life Today. I'm with Sayuri Rodriguez and we're doing a program about mentors today. In a series that we're calling Love at Home.
Amen.
Sayuri, you had just shared about how a gentleman who was your boss became your mentor, mm-hmm. that he gave you a very unusual interview, and that uh-huh. later on he was teaching you about God and focusing on God and making sure you stay humble and all of these wonderful things. Mm-hmm. I had an experience when I was young, when I was in junior high, and it was Christmas time. And the teacher went around and said, okay, we're going to do a gift exchange. And you'll buy a gift for so much amount of money for each person. And then on the day, we'll come to the table and we'll hand out the gifts. But at that time, my family was kind of struggling mm-hmm. with finances. I privately went to the teacher and I said, can I, you know, be kept out of this gift exchange thing? My parents have enough to worry about. Mm-hmm. I don't know how I told him, mm-hmm. but I said, I would just like to bow out this time. And he said, okay, that'd be fine. And so then I forgot about it.
Mm-hmm.
Well, we're all the excitement of the last day of school before Christmas break, and you're getting ready, and there is a table over there full of
and
presents.
Everybody was bringing.
And I think they did a thing where the teacher, one by one, they called a name, and the kids
okay.
went up and got their present. And I knew that there would be no present for me. But as the names were read, he said, Doug Garcia. I said, what? So I went up, and sure enough, there was not just one present, there was two.
Wow.
One of them was a little tin of hard candies,
uh-huh.
and the other one was a board game.
Huh.
And I said, wow. And it dawned on me. The teacher had himself, he and his wife, had gone out and got me something.
Wow.
And at lunchtime, I think it was, the teacher actually sat down and played the game with me. Now, what did this teach me? What was the mentor? Kindness. And being thoughtful of somebody else
right.
and looking out for somebody who might be having a little bit of a financial mm-hmm. problem at that time.
That's right.
And all these years, I've remembered his kindness towards
us. His kindness. You even remember the kind of
I remember the details because it stood out.
Yes.
It was a wonderful mentor experience. Mm.
And you know, now that you're talking about that, there are times that we get mentors just for one day. Or just for something specific. And then there are other times that it's for many, many days, mm-hmm. for a lifetime.
Yeah, mentors for a lifetime. Some people are fortunate enough to have a mentor for a lifetime.
Yes. Mm-hmm.
Well, you recorded some of your church members, and you asked them the question, what is a mentor?
Who was your mentor?
Oh.
Did you have a mentor? Yes. And who was this person? And what did this person teach you?
Well, let's take a look at that role right now. Let's see what they said.
My mentor is my mother. Her name is Vivian. She taught me how to have a positive attitude and told me that when things get rough, I just need to look up to God, because God is hope. And whenever I'm sad, that I just need to read my Bible and sing songs of psalms and praises to God.
Jean Mackey. She trained me many years ago in our career field, and we've been in touch ever since and have led very similar paths in life. And she has shown me through some very difficult times that she has had how to keep a positive attitude and to keep her eyes on Jesus through everything. So she's taught me so very much, and I'm very grateful.
My mentor, my first mentor in life, was my mother, Ruth Hogue, and she taught me that God loves me and he loves people, and that I should be loving and kind and sharing to all the people that I come in contact with.
Amen.
Well, Saidi, it seems like everybody has a mentor.
Yes, but I have to tell you something about this clip. Mm-hmm. The first lady, she just got baptized this last Sabbath.
Oh, okay.
Yes.
Wonderful.
And she is just on fire for the Lord. Mm-hmm. It's really beautiful. She was one that said, I'll do it. Even though I didn't have her scheduled to come, she was willing to come and to share. Now, the second lady, yes, she has gone through struggles, but it's one lady that I never see her serious. She always has a smile, even though she goes through trials. Mm. Now, the third lady, Margie, she told me something. You know how she mentioned that her mom was her mentor? Mm-hmm. She said that they grew up and they didn't have a lot of money, but she always saw her mom giving things away, even though they didn't have much, being kind to people. She said that there was one time that Margie was really excited because she got a doll. And it was this beautiful doll called Maria. And she loved her dolly. But one day she noticed that her neighbor, a little girl as well, she didn't have any toys. And so she decided to do what her mentor, her mom, had taught her. And by herself, she went ahead and she gave away her doll Maria to this neighbor. Isn't that beautiful?
What a wonderful teaching experience,
yes.
You know, something you'll remember. And she's remembered it.
It's beautiful.
We also had one gentleman who you interviewed. Mm-hmm. I wanted to show his clip. It's a little longer than the others, but he talks about how his neighbors became his mentor. Watch this.
Hello, my name is David Durant. I would have to say my mentor goes way back about 40 years ago. A couple that was at their time in their 50s, my neighbors, Willard and Vivian Purdy. Well, I asked if I could go to church with them at age 10. And so they, to cut the story short, talked to my mom, and my mom said, fine, and went to their house every Sabbath for breakfast, which I didn't eat breakfast. We couldn't afford it, I guess. But then I had some more time went by, and I went to a summer camp in Yosemite and decided I wanted to join the church. So they gave me Bible studies for 1 year, the 20th century kind ones. And then the next year I thought, oh, I get baptized now? They said, no, you're going to give us Bible studies. So that next year I gave them Bible studies. And then Dwayne Corwin, member here coincidentally, did evangelistic series, and I got baptized at the end of that series. And I remember one thing Willard told me. He says, David, you don't have to worry about anything, because you're the person that's going to take care of you is the Lord. It don't matter what college or school direction you want, the Lord's going to lead you that way. And you know, over the years, a lot of things have gone that way. God too is my mentor.
Amen.
Isn't that beautiful?
I like that story because that gentleman, because his neighbors took interest in this young boy. I think he said he was 10. Mm-hmm. And because of their efforts and their help, he got into church and was later baptized. Yeah. So you see how outside influences can help a family.
And also, I like this video clip because it shows what a mentor does. Number one, they teach you. Look at me. This is what I'm doing. He gave him a Bible study. But then the next step was, now you do it.
Now you
and we're right
study.
Here. You give the Bible study. Yeah. And then you let go and you see them continue doing the things that you're teaching.
Now, I mentioned grandparents earlier as being good mentors. Mm-hmm. We've got a lot of grandparents here at our church. Now, one gentleman who stopped by our studio the other day, his name is Ron Creary.
Yeah.
And he and his wife live here. And he is a grandfather. Mm-hmm. He has seen a lot in his life. And he knows that the Lord has helped him in many ways. And he shared one story that I want to share with our audience right now. When he was in academy, he was a rascal. And they came to the place one point where they were looking at maybe even kicking him out of school.
Wow.
So they brought him before a committee and they said, you know, has the time come for us to part ways, kind of. And something unusual happened. But I'm going to let him tell the story. Mm. Watch this story from Ron Creary.
But I did a lot of things I shouldn't be doing with that much knowledge even. Something has to change inside of a person. You can be taught all the doctrines, which I was. I was taught the doctrines, but it didn't make that effect on me. The thing that made effect on me were the kindness and the love of Jesus that shined on the faces of those that had to deal with a wayward, backsliding, undisciplined teenager. Till finally I got into trouble and not knowing where the boundaries were. And I could go on telling you about some of that, but I don't think there's any virtue in that at all. But I was called in the office by the discipline committee. And they said, this boy has got to go. There's going to be trouble here in this school. We're going to have bad reputation going around. Mr. Gammon, who was the principal, and he was always a stern person, he appeared, said, I want to talk to him alone. So he asked everybody else to leave the office. He said, Creary, you want to be a Christian? I said, sure, I want to be a Christian, but I don't know how. I've tried it. I've tried hard. How do you change loving things that you formerly loved? How do you stop loving the same things? Ready or not, here I come. Kind of an attitude. He says, Creary, I'm not kicking you out. I'm going to send you home for a day. But he says, I want you to know that you have access to my office anytime that you need me to talk to you and tell you stories. And if you want to bring somebody with you, do it. I'm not going to kick you out. I'm just sending you home for a week. So you think about things.
That was beautiful.
Wow. And so Ron told us that he got kicked out for that week. When he came back to school, he took that principal up on his offer. Mm-hmm. And he started coming to his office and talking to him. Mm-hmm. And the principal would tell him stories and they would share. That principal became his mentor. Mm-hmm. That principal showed him love.
Right.
And so here he was about to be kicked out. There's a number of things I like about this story. Mm-hmm. At the very beginning, he says that love made a difference. He says, I knew the doctrines. Mm-hmm. He said, but for me, love made the difference.
Right.
And the second thing was the principal took time to dig deeper. He said, I want to talk to him privately. And the principal got him alone and said, do you want to be a Christian? And so the principal was willing to take time to dig a little deeper before
right.
saying that kid's got to go.
Right.
The third thing was I liked about it was the principal said, I'm going to personally be involved. I'm going to open up my doors and say, kid, you can come over here and talk mm-hmm. to me anytime.
We make a decision.
Yeah.
That's
and the
right.
fourth thing is that you notice that Ron remembers this the rest of his life.
Yeah.
that had an influence on him that even today he talks about.
Mm.
So I like Ron's story, and I'm glad that the principal gave him a second chance, and even though it required effort and time, but in doing so, he became a wonderful mentor to Ron.
And when he went to talk to him, one of the things that stood out for me is that he said, I want to become a Christian, but I don't know how.
Yeah, there was no
And if
example.
There was no come to my office, they would never know that he didn't know how.
That's
and
right.
by the principal saying, you can come and everything, he started teaching him what he said. Doctrines are good, but to know the love of God, mm-hmm. that was displayed by the principal.
Well, friends, you've heard the stories, and you've seen how mentors can make a lasting impact on somebody's life. It's important to think now, what could I do?
Mm-hmm.
If you are a Christian, even if you, you know, you say, well, I've only been a Christian a month, a day, a year, whatever, it doesn't matter. You can still be a mentor for the Lord and find somebody in your church who needs encouragement or who needs support, or maybe you happen to have some nugget of wisdom mm-hmm. because you've already gone through a problem that you can share with somebody else. So think to yourself, please, this week, say, how could I be a mentor to somebody? And it may be within your own family, it may be within your workplace, or it may be within your church, but be a spiritual mentor.
Amen.
Do you have any other
Amen.
Thoughts?
I would say it's important to be a mentor, but also it may be that we are needing a mentor. And it's okay to say, would you be willing to be my mentor
That's right.
to someone that you consider would be able to help?
If you have a problem, be humble enough. You know, that,
yes.
that your mentor said be humble. Be humble enough to say, I need help.
Mm-hmm.
Well, we hope you've enjoyed this program about families. We want to do more of them. Mm-hmm. And remember, friends, that if you'll have a little bit of heaven on earth if you have love at home.
Amen.